to do that without worrying about getting fired. Valerie declined to do it because, as she told me, I think in the entire time of my employment with III, I didn't speak a single word to Mr. Fanati. And I said, well, I got that beat. In my entire 12 years at III, I probably spoke to Mr. Fanati 20 minutes total. So that's what I get to do. In any case, these two gentlemen, Mr. Fanati and Alfred Fanati and Ed Frenkid, are guiding lights in III, and that's the reason we're all here, is because of their guidance and wisdom in providing a workplace that was so conducive to good work, expert work, and competent work, and it provided such a good place for all of us to interact, that we're here. So they are basically the reason why we're here. And so for that little bit done, I want to introduce the president of this company, Mr. Alfred Fanati, and one of the founders of this company, Ed Frenkid. Gentlemen, come on up. Take this off. My understanding is we're going to. Bob has declined. Well, Bob, come on up.
Yeah.
All right, a third member of that studio now. And by the way, you are the vice presidents. We realize you are vice presidents, but, well, these are the guiding lights, and you were guiding lights a little later.
Mr. Fanati, welcome.
Well, it's great to see so many people. I realized that in all my time at III, we never had this number of people ever show up for work. As I thought about it, it was largely that half our staff was elsewhere in the world. Field service, sales. But still, our hours were lousy. I wanted Bob to join us because the III that we all know would not have existed without Bob and me having met Ed Frenkid at a time when we were running the Western Division of Computer Control. Ed turned out to be a consultant to us. We together submitted a proposal to Lawrence Livermore Labs for a, I guess you'd refer to as a multiprocessor, something which I think we're still working on today. Ed is, without a doubt, the brightest guy I've ever worked with. And he gracefully turned over the presidency to me, provided I would bring Bob Waller with me.
I remember it just slightly different. That I remember I met Bob Waller and I absolutely wanted to get him into the company, but he said he'll come, but only if he can bring Al with him as his boss. So that's how that happened.
On days like this, you look back at history and try to make some sense of it. And I noticed the newspapers today are still dealing with some of the same issues we dealt with back in 1965. In particular, I noticed that they're having trouble in Houston finding out what bathrooms people should use. It was somewhere probably in the mid-70s, at the end of a director's meeting, or staff meeting, I think Terry Toyner said, we're having a little trouble with the insurance company. They're not willing to pay the medical benefits to all the employees. And I said, Jesus, Terry, will all we pay those guys, make sure that they live up to their obligations. Well, he came and said, I don't think you understand. This is for sex hormones. The employees is having a sex change. So I said, well, you know, we're having enough trouble beating the equal employment opportunities requirements. let's be sure he or she feels welcome. And that was fine. They closed the meeting. A little while later, Jim Gay slips by the door and says, what bathroom shall I tell it to use? I remember back in our days, we used to think a three-man programming group could take on the world. As most of you know, I've moved on from III. I spent 5 years working on this book with Chris Kunze and Franz, and then joined a group to invest in Russia, and I'm now chairman of the board of a company in Russia that does about $1 billion a year in business called Yandex. It's Russia's answer to Google. But where we had one, two, or three men on a project, men or women, in Russia, we won't even start the project till we have 40 people. And I haven't figured out what they do. The difficulty is that the projects grow exponentially. I think 99% of people are talking with one another. Very few are getting the job done, but I haven't been able to influence that. Bob has more of a hearing problem than I do, but I think he might have some words about how we all got together. It was a series of accidents.
Ed mentioned the work we're going to do in multiprocessors. And the interesting thing was the computer control company in Information International, which is CCCIII, so we call the machine the 303, by the way. So now, when I wanted to comment, it's something probably you've never heard, but Al and I came to the company that had three orders, one for PDP-1, the PFR-1, PFR-2, and PFR-3, all of which were different. PFR-1 was a trivial modification of his original machine, which came along. The PFR-2 was an incredibly complex machine, which operated until what year did that run? What year did PFR-2 go?
Two is the high resolution was for Las Vegas.
1963 or 4.
It lived forever.
Yeah. Oh, it was used forever. Yeah. It was used by the AEC. It was used until nuclear testing stopped. That's what it was involved.
It's a very, very complex thing.
It did something most people thought was impossible.
That's right. In fact, the first programmer that tried this program was an MIT graduate student.
Bill Martin.
And he worked on it for like 3 months. He finally came to me and he said, I give up. I'm going to give up programming. I'm never going to program anything. John Hansen came in. And in 1 month, he had that machine running like a dream.
I came down, I was over in Cambridge, so I come down, and Bill Martin was a graduate student of Marvin Minsky, and so he'd been, I came to the, we were then located on Olympic,
right.
And I came there, and Bill Martin was working like this. He had a cot in the office. He did not go out of the office day and night. When he was awake, he was working, and when he couldn't stay up anymore, he would sleep on the cot. As soon as he woke up, he'd work again. And he'd written this beautiful code. He was a fantastic coder. was the key person behind something called Maxima, which turned into Mathematica later. But basically, that was a project in MIT. So he was an MIT graduate student who was, you know, supposed to do write this program. And here's what his problem was. The computer was the DDP-24. Okay, that was a machine that came from the old company of these two guys. Okay. It had a Fortran compiler. So Bill Martin was very methodical. He programs the whole program on paper. This isn't my style of program. When he's all done, he compiled it. And it compiled to about 30,000 words, but the machine only had 16,000. 8,000 words. So he's feverishly trying to reduce the code and so on and so forth. So I came down there, and I'm having him explain all this to me and so on, and the guy was like bleary-eyed and, you know, and so on. I said, look, okay, you've explained this to me. Go back to MIT and finish your damn doctorate. And he left, okay. So I took the code, and it was just so beautiful. All I did, and it was very easy for me, is I partitioned it because part of the code was to sort of calibrate itself. And another part was to do something else. And there was a tape drive on this machine. So I had this trivial job, which I just did by myself, which is I divided this code up into about 3 or 4 pieces. And we put the pieces together. The thing that sort of annoyed me, I was going to use a vulgar explanation, was that Lawrence Radiation Laboratory then hired, when we told them we were done, they said, don't ship it to us yet. And they hired a company to test our machine to see if it made the specs. And they paid them. That company made more profit than we did. It met all the specs, and from then on, you know, it served. What it did was, when they did a nuclear test, they would get the result of a little curve on film, and by reading it, they could figure out what the yield was. Wow. And with my gadget, our gadget, Triple I gadget, it could do it in an hour, say, while the old way had people working like slaves with a mechanical kind of optical thing, it would take maybe a week. So this was much faster. Here's a funny sequel. One day, a man comes into the office, he tells me he's from the CIA. And I say, yeah, what do you want? And he says, this isn't Cambridge. And he says, well, we have reason to believe that the French government is going to want to buy one of your PFR2s. And I thought, what would they want with the PFR2? And he said, well, you know, they're developing nuclear weapons and so on and so forth. I thought, okay. This just struck me as bizarre, because this was all highly secret. I had to have a Q clearance, you know, and things like that. And so that meant that there were French spies in the U.S. Atomic Energy Agency, and U.S. spies in the French government. So I thought they were all cracked. About a week later, a guy comes into the office and says, he was some attaché at the French embassy, and he says, we'd like to buy a PFR too. Anyway, so a lot of anecdotes like that.
Secret here. When Al and I joined the company, it was because of the presence of the orders for the three machines that were very enticing to us. They had huge backlogs of the company, it was an interesting product, challenging, and so we joined, and we're going to join, and Ed's lawyer suggested that we had to put up some earnest money. And we invested in it, and we get back to Cambridge. And a gentleman by the name of George Michael, all the top of us. And George comes in and he said, I represent Lawrence Livermore Laboratories. BG&G, which was buying the PFR 2, White Sands, who was buying the PFR 1, and Holloman Air Force Base, who was buying the PFR 3, which was a different than what we all used also. But anyway, George comes in and he said, I'm here to cancel all three contracts. And he said, I said, give us a chance. And, he said, but what happened, of course, the guy that needed us, needed somebody, is that his final engineer was ruined. And he was left with his orders, never did do anything with it. And George Michael said, you can't do it, you don't have an engineer, why would you do it? And I said, well, you know, we joined the company to work on it. And I said, George, could you give me 90 days?
Well, that, was, said, the only, right, that was only the second time that we're bankrupt. there's an add-on to the story of the French. That went on through the formal procurement process and the various representatives of the Department of Defense and the State Department all have to vote on this. And clearly, the order was not going to go through. But about 6 months later, we got a, I guess it almost was received the mail, an order from the CIA for, at that point, PFR 3. No advance notice, no discussion of what it was going to do, but we got the order. And that was, I think, the government's way of making up for the fact that they'd gotten away of the role of procurement. So the next point I remember, though, is this precision machine was delivered to the outskirts of Washington, somewhere up to the northwest, the other side of the river from Georgetown. And as we did in those days, Ken Cordry was the person of choice to make a delivery. So we didn't have the internet at that time. But, so I guess it was a phone call. Somebody's reporting that the machine is all apart on the sidewalk outside this three-story building. It wouldn't fit in the elevator. We finally got there, and then it had to, that only fit in the elevator, had to fit through the door. The whole second floor of the building was a screen room so that no radio waves could go in or out. But it had to then fit through the door and be reassembled inside the screen room. And we never heard from those people again. changes of the company, at that point we were going to make our fortune with programmable film readers. We felt that film was a great recording media, and that getting an interface between that and modern computers was going to make our fortunes. The order for the CIA was the last. But it turned out that at that time the aerospace industry had standardized on 35-millimeter film and punch cards for handling large files of drawings for the space program, for an airplane, and for the telephone system. So we somehow or other fell heir to the president of the Microfilm Association, George Harmon. And after months of work, we were able to imitate the image that one would get from a planetary camera photographing a lines per millimeter chart. Bob did it by basically cheating on the illumination, getting it down to the point where it looked like 80 line pairs per millimeter, and from then on we were, the company basically shifted from reading film to recording film.
By the way, someone asked me, I don't remember who, would I tell something of the original history of III, which led, was before I met these two guys. I don't know, do you want to hear that or not?
No, we want to start talking.
Yes. wants to hear that, you can let me know, or I don't know what to do.
Yes.
If you get bored, tell me, I'll shut up. Okay, so here's what happened. I was a fighter pilot in the Air Force, okay, and I was based in a place called Hanscom Field in Massachusetts. And the Air Force lent me to Lincoln Laboratory, which was there, and sort of forgot about me, which was nice from my perspective, okay? And so I got a chance to learn all about computers, and then I invented something called tree memory while I was there. And by the way, this is a very funny thing, I invented this thing, and you know, the Air Force couldn't care less one way or another, and I wrote it up and whatever. The result is that that particular thing I invented is the most commonly used information retrieval system in the United States state. This is Google runs with it, and so on. Almost all retrieval systems use it. Okay, so here's what was happening. I was working for BBN, and the world was very strange then, you know. There was nuclear war was probably going to happen, people thought, and all kinds of strange things like that. And, you know, it's very hard to put you back into the psychology that existed then. But what happened is I and a very good friend of mine, Lowell Silver, who worked at BBN, decided to quit and go to Brazil. And the reason we wanted to go to Brazil is because this fantastic guy had just been elected president, a guy named Quadros, a very amazing person. And he just seemed so amazing and fantastic to us that we wanted to go, and someone else from Bell Labs wanted to go. So the three of us decided to do that. And so I told my boss at BBN, we told him, we're leaving. He was very upset. That was Licklider. Guy. So, but not long afterwards, the generals in Brazil deposed Quadros, and so that ended that idea. So I went to Lincoln and said, okay, we don't have to leave. And he said, look, you made me so upset telling me you're going to leave, so now leave. So we're suddenly out of a job. And I just called someone up at Digital and said, hey, I'm out of a job. And he said, I'll meet you for lunch. That was Harlan Anderson. He met us for lunch, and he agreed to hire both of us as consultants. So Rollo and I decided to create a company, okay? Now, Rollo and I were such terrific friends. We really liked each other, you know, and got along well and so on. We'd talk about this, that, and the other. And we discovered that together, we could get about one-tenth as much done as either of us could do by himself. I felt very, very guilty, but I decided I was going to have to just break this up and, you know, go and start a company by myself. And I finally told him. And he said, well, you know, I've had the same thought, and I've already got a job at MITRE. So that worked out. So I went to Digital and said, okay, I don't want to just sit in this office here consulting to you. I want to start a company. And I had no money whatsoever. I did, you know, I had no savings. None. So I worked a deal with Digital where if I started a company, they would pay me my regular consulting rate for any number of hours I would bill them a week. So if I got outside business, they wouldn't get billed much. And if I got no outside business, I'd be full time. And I told him, well, there's one other thing you have to promise. I'm going to bill you at 5:30 on Friday afternoon. You have to pay me Monday morning. And they said, okay. So with that, I went and rented 3,300 square feet of floor space in the mill in Maynard. The guy says, okay, I need 2 months rent in advance. And I said, I'll pay you 1 month at the end of the month. And he said, okay. So with no money whatsoever, I remember an accountant came in to set up my books. And he said, okay, what are your assets? I said, I don't have any. And he said, you can't start a company without any assets. And I said, well, I don't have any. And he says, whose toolbox is that over there? And I said, that's mine. He said, okay, that's the company's, and that's $500 worth. Assets are day zero. So, you know, I just started, and I could do, if I got some consulting business, then I would consult a little less to digital. So, with this company was profitable all the time. I decided to train a bank. I had been in Europe while I was at BBN, and there was a guy who cheated a bank there by pretending he was a member of the family that owned Fiat. And, what happened is I saw this picture of some gendarmes carrying this guy off, and the caption said, but he was staying at the George Sank Hotel. And what it was a guy came into this bank and said, I'm, one of the Fiat family people, and he borrowed some money. Then he borrowed more money, then he borrowed more money. And then the guy at the bank sees a picture of him in the paper as the terror of Monte Carlo, who bets the limit on the number, which is 30-1 odds at roulette. So in any case, I had this idea, my God, what made the banker give him the money? And I analyzed that very carefully, and I decided I was going to train a bank. So I called a bank and got a guy to come in. And the way I trained him was, every month I told him what I was going to do the next month, and I did it. In other words, I was a bit calculated in order to make it happen, but I did. Okay. So, and the reason that was, it turned out to be very important, because when later on I got some business, we had to, we needed the bank. Okay. So I'm going to just run on. One day I get a phone call from someone who says, hey, I'm at Woods Hole Oceanographic Institute, and we hear you're out not working at BBN. We need to hire someone. So I said, well, I'm not for hire, but I'll come down. Then they called me and said, will you give a ride to someone who's also coming down to Woods Hole? So, okay, they gave me the name of a person. I drove over to Harvard University and picked this guy up. We start driving down to Woods Hole. So he turned out to be a very interesting guy. Like me, he wasn't a college graduate, but he was a professor at Harvard. I thought that was interesting. So, his name was Henry Stommel, and he's telling me about oceanographics and so on. And by the time we got to Woods Hole, I had described how, from what he told me about of what he called a vortex ocean model, that we could program that up on a PDB-1 computer, and I could have display ocean currents on the screen of a computer, which was novel in those days. And so by the time we got to Woods Hole, he said, we'll give you a $10,000 contract to write that program. That was my first outside contract, $10,000. Today it would be like maybe $100,000 to $150,000. Okay, so we got that contract. Now here's how we got into film. At Woods Hole, they showed me the Richardson current meter. In those days, there were no computer chips and so on. So they made something to go down in the ocean to see. They discovered there were ocean currents that were not at the surface, but down deep. And the ocean at the surface may move this way, but down deep it may move that way or something. So they had these meters, which would, it was like a 6-foot-long steel pipe, and it measured how fast the ocean current was going and which way, and recorded it on 16-millimeter film with little tiny lights and little fiber optic things, and to move the lights from the compass to the so on. It was all very mechanical and so on. And then they built a machine to read that film. I looked at the machine to read the film, and I looked back and I said, that'll never work. And they said, who are you? And of course it'll work, and so on and so forth. So that's right. Okay. So some months later, they call me up and say, it didn't work. And you said you could make something to fix it, to read it. So here's a very, I have to tell you this, but this is insanely funny. Okay. Just me, at least. Okay. So I decide I'm going to make a film reader. And here's how I'm going to do it. I'm going to take a regular, I knew that 16-millimeter projector you could rent from a company, and it had, it could stop, and then you could say advance one frame by clicking, you know, just advance one frame, you know, one at a time. So I thought, say I take the light bulb out and put a photomultiplier in, and I point it at the screen of the computer. Then the light will come from the screen, go through the lens, be focused on the film, some would go through the film to the photomultiplier, and I would be able to tell how much light got through, and we could write a program to do the rest. That was my idea, okay? And since it pulled it down one frame at a time, I figured if I could mill out the little gate that held the film so the computer could see above the frame and below it, so it, when it pulled it down, it could figure out what was lost, it could do it all, okay? Not having any money, we rented that projector. And I got Digital to use their milling machine to mill it out. And but I needed, and I bought the photomultiplier tube, and I got Ben Gurley to design the circuitry and connect it to the computer, but so to make a long story short, we got that to run. And that, there's this one thing. I got the photomultiplier tube, but no one had the connector. A photomultiplier tube was like a vacuum tube, but it had like 16 pins and a very odd connector. And I thought, oh, the Lincoln Labs has this electronics warehouse like inside with parts for everything. So I called someone, since I used to work there, and said, look, do me a favor, sneak into the parts area, take that part and just give it to me. And I've ordered one, but I'm not going to get it for a while, and when I get it, I'll give it to you and you can put it back. So it's not actually a theft. And he said, okay, I'll do it. And he asked me, why do you want it? And I told him, well, I'm doing this stuff for Woods Hole and I need it to meet some film and blah, blah, blah. And no one had ever read film with a computer up there, I thought. Okay, so he gives me the part, we get it going right away, and we're reading this film. And, you know, it turned out that that solved that problem. But meanwhile, this very funny thing happened, and this is just fate, okay? Someone from Lincoln Labs found out about all this. And someone called me and said, hey, you're reading some kind of film? Is that what you use that thing for? And I said, yeah. And they said, well, we tried to read some film, so we built a gadget and did the same thing you did. We pointed it at the screen of the computer and so on, but they can't make the software work. Could you? Okay, so I say, well, you know, come down and tell me about it. Okay, so they come down, and what happens is this. There's some army people, and they have a radar that's looking at a missile coming in and records on film. It's the only way you can record things in those days, an oscilloscope on film. And they asked, could we read it? And so to make a long story short, we signed a contract for X bucks. I think it was 10,000 again, that number kept coming out. And they said, they kept emphasizing, we're in a great hurry, great hurry, great hurry. Okay. So we signed this contract on Friday. Okay. So I told all the guys who worked with me then, we had quite a look, we got to get this done quickly, so we camped there for the weekend at work. We had cots, we didn't go home. We worked all weekend long. We got it all, got their device hooked to our computer, so it was for 35-millimeter film. We wrote the programs, we made the programs work, and on Monday morning I called him up and said, hey, can you come down? He came down and we showed him what was working. I thought he would be overjoyed. They were angry. Because they said, you've cheated us. You know, this was like, you know, $100,000 or $150,000 today. And here's just, you know, They said, you've done nothing, you know, and we have to pay you $10,000. Okay, so I pointed out, I got our timesheets, and at our regular consulting rates, we had about four guys working on it every hour the whole weekend, and we got it done. So they got the Army to agree to buy one for $500,000. Okay, that was the PFR-1. The bank I had been training financed us.
Good training.
And we built the PFR-1 and we're off and running. So that's nice.
I think maybe it's time to sit down.
What happened to the 10-cent Coke machine?
Probably in the archives.
How about another round of applause? Lunch will be served shortly, and Teresa will give you the go ahead. In the meantime, you should probably talk with those people who are near where you're sitting. Don't go too far from your table.